Good afternoon. You're watching Nine News Now. I'm Amber Sherlock. The Prime Minister is back in Canberra today, meeting with department heads and key ministers as Scott Morrison maps out the agenda of his re-elected government. Let's go live to political reporter Kerry Axley. Good afternoon, Kerry. What are Mr Morrison's priorities?
Well, Amber, he today spoke about keeping the budget in good shape to fund promises in health, education, mental health for young people and the National Disability Insurance Scheme in particular. He said this in front of the heads of government departments in the Cabinet Room here at Parliament House. He wants us to know that he expects an efficient bureaucracy that will deliver on the government's agenda promptly. He also spoke about foreign affairs, which is an area that didn't come up too often during the campaign. Here is what he had to say about that.
The world is an increasingly uncertain place, and I've had many discussions with people around this room about the uncertainties that present, not just in the economic sphere but in the strategic sphere as well. And I think it's very important that we continue to focus on the ways that we can use our influence and our relationships and build on those relationships in the Indo-Pacific region.
And Amber, meanwhile, it seems like there is no contest for the Labor leadership. Shadow Finance Minister Jim Chalmers won't contest the leadership. He took last night to weigh up his options, but said he's out because basically he didn't think that he could get enough support. And if he did, he said that he couldn't. It would be hard for him to do because he has young kids. So if no one puts up their hand over the next few days, Anthony Albanese will be the next leader, Amber.
Kerry, thank you. One of Australia's leading racehorse owners, Damien Flower, has been charged over his alleged role in smuggling cocaine from South Africa. Police say the drugs were being transported on commercial flights. A baggage handler at Sydney Airport has also been arrested, accused of using his airside access to import cocaine through the baggage holds. Border Force allegedly found 27 kilograms of cocaine in Flower's car. Indonesia's capital, Jakarta, is bracing for a third night of violence as the anger over the re-election of Joko Widodo as president shows no sign of easing. Nine's Asia correspondent Renee Henry has the latest.
I'm in central Jakarta outside one of the main election offices targeted in last night's escalated violence. The tear gas is still thick in the air. I can feel it in my eyes and in my throat. This is the barbed wire fence, which clearly was breached by rioters at times. If we come over here, we can see sections of the street which have been trashed by the rioters. Chunks of cement like that were picked up and hurled by the protesters. Over there was a police tent that was set alight. Over there, police are once again setting up their barricades. Today is about mopping up, but also about preparing for the unrest that could be still to come. Overnight was absolute chaos. These rioters used Molotov cocktails, firecrackers, whatever they could get their hands on to hurl at police. Police responded with rubber pellets, with tear gas, with water cannons. Once again, not allowed to use live ammunition in a bid to keep the number of casualties down. On the first night of protests alone, six people died and more than 200 were injured. Last night, we saw dozens of people being ferried away in ambulances again. Hundreds of these rioters are now in custody. The re-elected president, Joko Widodo, promising that they will cop the full brunt of the law. Meantime, the losing opponent of his, Prabowo Subianto, is refusing to accept responsibility for the violence, instead blaming third-party provokers. His challenge to the election result also goes to the Constitutional Court today, a result from that may not be known for weeks, meaning this unrest could continue for some time.
A 37-year-old man is in hospital after he was found in Sydney southwest with a gunshot wound. It follows an earlier incident at Canley Vale where a mother and a baby were left terrified after shots were fired at their family home. Police are working to determine whether the two shootings are linked. It marks the fifth separate incident in the city southwest in less than 48 hours. A community in Melbourne's north is in shock after a man was stabbed to death inside a home. Lana Murphy reports.
Samir Mayoub has been charged with murder after allegedly stabbing a man outside his home here in Campbellfield last night. The violence unfolded just after 9 o'clock, police alleging the 42-year-old attacked a 61-year-old on the road outside his property after he came to collect an unpaid trades bill. An inconsolable woman arrived at the scene around the same time as emergency services, who couldn't do anything to save the man as he bled out on the road.
There was a lady in hysterics crying on the street. She fainted when I got closer. I did see the gentleman on the ground. He was covered in blood. Police were trying to resuscitate him.
Businessman Samir Mayoub was arrested at the scene and questioned by detectives alongside a 51-year-old man who was soon released without charge. Nine News has been told the 61-year-old victim was a cabinet maker who visited to collect an unpaid debt after doing work in Mayoub's kitchen.
Horrible. Felt sad. It's not what you expect. I hear it all the time, people don't expect it, but you really don't, especially murder.
He was stabbed once, with neighbours running to try and save his life. It's understood the accused called 000 himself. Mayoub appeared briefly in the Melbourne Magistrates Court today and will reappear in August.
Two people are in hospital following a nasty crash at a car park on Sydney's North Shore this morning. A woman was thrown from her car after hitting a pedestrian at Chatswood Bowling Club. It's believed she accidentally pressed the accelerator instead of the brake. The woman in her 80s is in a critical condition, while the man in his 30s is being treated for a suspected broken leg. A man is in hospital after being crushed by a tractor in Brisbane's southwest this morning. It is believed the 21-year-old was pinned under the tractor after it flipped down an embankment at a golf course in Indooroopilly. Emergency crews were able to pull the man from under the rig. He is now being treated for serious injuries. Mining giant Adani has met with Queensland regulators to try and agree on final environmental approvals for the Carmichael mine. Adani Chief Executive Lucas Dow says he's happy there is now some clarity on the issue following long delays. It comes after the state's Premier Anastasia Palaszczuk ordered the meeting following Labor's wipeout in the federal election. Excitement is growing with just over 24 hours to go until it's lights on in Sydney for this year's Vivid Festival. More than 2 million people are expected to check out the light show, which transforms the city into a sea of colour, music and fun.
We're very proud of being able to put on this amazing event. We've got guest speakers from all over the world as part of our ideas program. Some of the great artists of the world are here as part of the music program. And there are so many fantastic light installations, over 50 around all different parts of the city.
Vivid will run from 6 p.m. every night from tomorrow until the 15th of June. One of the Cancer Council's largest fundraising events, Australia's Biggest Morning Tea, has kicked off today to fund research, prevention and support services for those affected by cancer. Anyone can be involved and it will stretch from today all the way until the end of June. It's hoped to raise $12 million across Australia.